Awesome. Let me go ahead. I'll share, start my screen share here. All right. And let me make this big. All right. So again, thanks very much for the invite. Thanks for the opportunity to speak to y'all for a little bit today. So the title of the talk is Rootedness in Language Variation, the Need to Quantify Place Attachment. And so I'll go through exactly what I mean by place attachment here in just a minute. And my term for place attachment is rootedness. This is kind of a fun term because, you know, growing up around a lot of plants and trees, the idea of being rooted and being, you know, how important the root system is just really appealed to me. So what I'm going to be talking about today, so I'll talk about what is place and why place is important. In particular, I'll spend some time about place and language. I'll talk about some of my work in Appalachia and in particular how rootedness has affected that. And then why is this important and then where do we go? I've got some work that's ongoing here, a little different part of the world. So in Alabama, not in Tennessee where I'm from and where I did most of my this work. But I've got some interesting things that some students have been working on that I'm working on that I hope to have time to touch on at the tail end of the talk. So we'll start off with, what is place? So Agnew 2002 outlines three components of place. The first is locale. And so that's the setting in which everyday life is concentrated for a group of people. So basically, it's literally the sort of the geographic spot. So where is the locale? The second is location. And so location is the fact that this spot of geography is both part of a bigger whole, but also separate. So it has some links to here, as you said, both the wider networks, but also to where it is embedded. So there's this idea of being part of something larger, but still be having some sense of being distinct. And then and obviously you can see where this is going, the sense of place. And so the symbolic identification with place as distinctive and constitutive of a personal identity and a set of personal interests. So when you have a piece of geography that is both part and distinct, and you can identify with that place, that's when you really have this notion that Agnew calls place. So obviously, that's something that lots of people have recognized. Most people can easily recognize, and often that's one of the first things that people comment on in our classes, right? When we have those intro classes, oh, well, somebody from, you know, Ireland sounds different from London, or somebody from Boston sounds different from Alabama, right? And they list all sorts of things. Pronunciations, lexical items. One of my favorite things to do here in the U.S. South is ask my students, what is barbecue? So those of you that are not familiar with the culinary arts of the U.S., barbecue is one of the terms that can either be like the event itself, where you go to a celebration where there's a food, so you're going to a barbecue. Some people, it's actually the act of cooking meat, so like putting it onto a grill. But for us in the South, depending on where you're from in the South, it can be the type of meat that you're going to consume. So where I'm from in East Tennessee, it was slow roasted pork that was chopped up for sandwiches. When I lived in Memphis, Tennessee, a city in the west part of Tennessee, it's pork ribs. When I lived in Texas, it's beef brisket. And there's all these great discussions. So one of my sort of favorite things to do is to bring that up into class. And that usually, you know, the first one or two days of class, we have a lot of lively discussion about that. And the next thing you know, we're talking about all sorts of things. So I do tend to bring up food a lot. So sorry about that. People comment and our students comment on these things. But also, it's important because that is one of the features of language variation. And it's something that is that as scholars of language have looked at, it's really been happening since ancient times. So in the book of Judges, you have the Gileadites and the Ephraimites talking about how you pronounced Shibboleth, which is why we got that word. Now, granted, hopefully it doesn't have the same tragic consequences. But Panini, even at roughly the same time, maybe just a little after indicated regional variation in his writings. Yang Xiong in China discussed regional usages and possibly pronunciations in China in about 200 BCE. Sextus Empiricus in Rome talked about regional variation across the Roman Empire. And then early Arabic grammarians a little bit later, about 800 CE, sought elicitation from various tribespeople around the Arabian Peninsula. And in particular, they wanted to avoid urban areas because in urban areas brought so many people together that you couldn't tell where people were from. So this idea that place impacted language is ancient. And again, it's something that, you know, even to this day, that's one of the first things that our students talk about. And of course, as we start moving into more modern times, the idea about place affecting language is not new. The German dialect survey by Vanker, was in the late 19th century. Was one of the first big sort of dialectology studies. Guillaron in France did obviously the French dialect study where sent his field worker out on his bicycle all across France and was able to again to see and to understand how much the production of language varied across France. And of course, moving to the United States, the Linguistic Atlas of the United States and Canada. So the project that started in the early to mid 20th century and continues to this day. And the Atlas of North American English. So again, LeBov's one of his magna opera, where he called using a telephone survey and sort of really canvassed the entirety of the of North America. And again, in all of those, the idea of place mattered. But with all of these, from the ancient grammarians to now, what people were noticing is that the locale and the location, right? So they were talking about geography. And in particular, they were talking about how these places were, part of a wider network, but also somewhat, somewhat distinct, right? So you're drawing isoglosses where this production is here and this production is here. So we're getting this idea of place from a locale and a location. But in none of these do they really talk about how each individual felt about that place. Because now, granted, it wasn't the goal of these studies, but it's also with doing that, you kind of get the idea that every person is affected by place in the same way. So if you're below this isogloss, this is a bit simplistic, but if you're within this area, everyone sounds the same. But we know that that's not true. And we know that as we've interacted with people from just in our lives, as we've sort of looked, as we've, listened, you can tell that not everyone from any particular place sounds the same. So I just basically said that. So we're seeing the locale and location, but not so much the sense of place. Now, granted, this can be construed as me like throwing off on these studies, and that's not what I'm doing because that wasn't their goal. Their goal was to sort of track the movement of people and to track the language change over time, and really just looking at linguistic geography, which is that was their goal. So the idea of incorporating the sense of place was not necessarily part, because again, different methods with different aims. But when you start thinking about why should we consider sense of place and why do we need to do something like this? So Barbara Johnstone, writing in 2004, said regions have come to be seen as meaningful places which individuals construct as well as select as reference points. So it's not just that place affects everyone, but an individual is involved in that process. They're selecting and constructing that place also. And LePage and Tabaret Keller discussed it, that an individual creates for himself the patterns of his linguistic behavior so as to resemble those of the group or groups with which from time to time he wishes to be identified, so as to be unlike those from whom he wishes to be distinguished. So again, if we know that people are selecting region as sometimes one of the things that people want to orient toward, and other times they may want to orient away, or they want to sound like this person but not that person, that's where this sense of place comes in, because region and place have meaning and have meaning for groups of people and individuals. So obviously one of the kind of the seminal papers with this idea is LaBeouf 63, writing about Martha's Vineyard. In this study, the speaker's feelings about the island affected their vocalic productions, right? So those that had a more positive view of the island versus those that had a negative view of the island had differing vocalic productions. Other sort of work in this vein, so Lane in Denmark, this was interesting because speakers with the most regional features actually interacted more with non-locals, which kind of goes contrary to what we might expect, right? So with in LaBeouf's work, it was the people that interacted with the tourists that sounded the most unlike the islanders. Here in Lane's work, you're finding those that interacted most with the locals had more of the features. And in this sense, it's, you know, the theory was that because they had such regional pride, they wanted to make sure that they had those regional features in their speech. Johnstone and colleagues in Pittsburgh, it's not so much just that people want to sound a certain way, but they, by sounding a certain way, it expresses various aspects of that place and what that place means to both locals and non-locals. So in Pittsburgh, what they called Pittsburghese, sounding a certain way gave you access to present yourself with those characteristics. So some of them were, a blue collar type of lifestyle, or a particular type of blue collar lifestyle. Other aspects of Pittsburgh and what Pittsburgh meant to locals and also to people of Western Pennsylvania. So again, this idea that your sense of place shifts how you produce language. In the Yucatan Solomon's work, this was an area where there were large urban centers and then a lot of rural areas around the urban centers. And the idea of using particular productions, some would sort of signify that you were orienting towards the urban areas in the sense that you had a more cosmopolitan idea. And if you didn't use those that were associated with urbanity and cosmopolitanism, then you were sort of orienting towards more traditional ways of life. So again, the various ways that you produce language helped people understand how you felt about place. Shukasey in New Orleans. So New Orleans, especially in the aftermath of Hurricane Katrina in 2005, so a lot of people had to leave the city, and a lot of people then had to sort of relocate back to their city, but also a lot of people couldn't leave. And in the aftermath, there's a lot of people that came to New Orleans from other places. And so obviously it's been known for a long time that New Orleans has sort of a unique dialect. However, people started using their dialect to perform their localness. And so you started to see the rise of sort of like selling shirts and cups and things with various types of New Orleans speech on them, in the sense that people were using this as a way to signal, we're here, this is New Orleans, and we have pride in this place. And so, we're not leaving, or we're coming back because this is home. And so again, this idea that this place has a particular, captures someone's imagination, even sometimes at a subconscious level, that they want to express, this is who I am and this is where I'm from. Carmichael's work, still in New Orleans, it was even, this is something very fascinating because New Orleans is a city of neighborhoods and wards. If you followed any of the hurricane stuff, you'd heard about like the Lower Ninth Ward and the other wards. So there is a particular neighborhood, Chalmette, that is in New Orleans. And her speakers, from her studies, it's not so much New Orleans as a whole, it's their particular neighborhood within New Orleans. And again, they have some various productions, some of which mirror other sort of broader New Orleans features, but some that are more unique to Chalmette itself. And so again, the idea that place and as how a speaker felt about place, because in the aftermath of the hurricane, some of the people from Chalmette had to leave and they had to move a pretty good distance away across Lake Pontchartrain, like to the North Shore is what they called it. And those that had to relocate that had the strongest, what she calls Chalmatian orientation, the fact that they wanted to move back when they could, those that had moved with this stronger orientation had the most features and had the most, the highest density and proportion of the features of her study. So there you're seeing again that it wasn't just place, it was a particular neighborhood. And it wasn't just everyone in the neighborhood, it was those that had a particular orientation. So again, that starts setting the stage for some of my work. So this is where I work. So this is Appalachia in the United States. So it's 410 counties across 13 states. Now I've highlighted, so what's circled in red is what a lot of people refer to as sort of the Appalachian core. And this comes from some work from geographers that asked people both inside the region and outside the region, where is Appalachia? And so this is sort of like a mental map of where most people in the United States consider to be the core of Appalachia. So you can see it's a much less expansive region. And this is sort of where the spine of the Appalachian Mountains runs. And of course, here, this is where a lot of the caricatures of the region are situated. So, you know, this is where, you know, if you've heard of the Hatfields and McCoys, or if you've heard of the hillbillies, that term, this is the where a lot of those things originated. I am from right here, and we'll see a closer map in just a minute. So in Appalachia, because it's a place that has been both part of the South and not necessarily part of the South, part of the U.S., but sometimes also seen as distinct, there is a very obvious and something that we talk about a lot as Appalachian people, that we talk about place. So I can remember hearing about place basically my entire life. And so Loyal Jones, an Appalachian sociologist and historian, wrote in 1975 about Appalachia, "We are oriented around places. We never forget our native places, and we go back as often as possible. Our place is always close on our minds. It is one of the unifying values of mountain people, the attachment to one's place." And now this is not necessarily unique to the mountains, this idea of place being very important, but it is something that gets highlighted very often, usually via language. So when I was younger and we started and I traveled around, one of the first things that people would remark is, "You sound funny, where are you from?" And it's not necessarily just sounding funny, but it's sounding a particular way can evoke meanings in people's minds. And we'll hear more about that in just a minute. Writing a little bit later, Jones talked about one of the Appalachian values is a love of place. So this is something that, you know, he traveled throughout the region, spoke a lot, wrote a lot about the region. And this is one of the things that he pulled out as like one of the Appalachian values was a love of place. And people in Appalachia and other places, but they talk often about the word homeland. So when you ask me about home, I usually refer to the homeland. And what's also very interesting is that sometimes people will even use the term home place. And it can be something that is a literal place, like, you know, my parents' home where I grew up is the home place. But it doesn't necessarily have to be a place that you spend a lot of time. So Bridget Anderson, she studied some Appalachian migrants that had moved during the Great Appalachian Migration from Western North Carolina, Eastern Tennessee, and Southwest Virginia to the Detroit metro area for economic opportunities. And when she was working among these communities, what she found was that people that were in the second and third generations, so people that really and honestly did not grow up in those places and had spent summers or spent time there, but not an enormous amount of time, still referred to certain places as the homeland and the home place. So this idea of home and place is sort of very present among Appalachian people. So this is where all of my data come from that I'm going to be discussing, or most of the data I'm going to be discussing. So this is Tennessee, and this is Hancock County, Tennessee. So this is the state of Virginia, the state of Kentucky. I'm just sort of giving you some states so you can sort of orient yourself. So this is a very small county, very mountainous in East Tennessee. So the county is quite small. So there's about 6,600 total people there. In the county seat of Sneedville, there's about somewhere between 1,000 and 1,100 people. So this is, again, a very small, very rural county. According to the U.S. Census, the entire county is considered extremely rural. So this is home. That's where I grew up. And so all of the data that I'm going to be talking about for a lot of these studies came from interviews that I conducted for in 2014 and 2015. So in one study, I looked at two generations from the same family in Hancock County. They were all born, raised, and partially educated in Appalachia, and all of them have postgraduate education. So this is a grandmother and her granddaughters. So the older speaker, the grandmother, she was 81 years old. She was a retired school teacher and school administrator. She had a bachelor's plus, so she had taken a lot of postgraduate coursework as an educator, sort of continuing ed types of things. Three younger speakers. Suzanne was an attorney. Hannah was a business manager. And Morgan was a university educator. So at the time of their recordings, all of them had post bachelor degrees, so a JD and master's degrees. So again, you've got fairly highly educated women, all from this area. And again, these are people that I've known my whole life. So when we sat down for our conversation, it was very relaxed. It was very chill. You know, normally when you record someone, you get that, you know, first 5 or 10 minutes where they're a little like leery of the recorder. This didn't happen as much. It was something that was kind of fun to do because the minute we sat down and I started asking them about, you know, what they did for the holidays, they just started talking. So it was great. So I was looking at the monophthongization of the diphthong I. So where a word like my is realized as my, or a word like time is realized like time. So this is a hallmark of the South, of the U.S. South. But in particular, in Appalachian English, it is not just in my and in time, it's also in a word like right. So where it's realized as right. So you'll get my, time, and right. That is a production that is sort of widespread across the South. But when you get it in that pre-voiceless condition, that is much more geographically constrained, and it's also more socially stigmatized. And so that's what, when you start seeing these graphs, this is what I'm talking about, the proportion of monophthongal realizations of the diphthong I. So here we have a chart from that paper, and Hazel, the grandmother, was basically categorically monophthongal in every possible opportunity. It was glorious. So she talked about my and time and white and right and rice. It's just great. And then you see two of the younger speakers were very monophthongal. You know, they're not quite as monophthongal as their grandmother, but they are very monophthongal. And then we have one sister who is basically diphthongal all the time. She's basically categorically diphthongal. She is very distinct from her siblings and from her grandmother. So if you look based on style, so you've got some conversational and then reading, and what you're seeing is that in Hazel, the grandmother, doesn't change, but Hannah and Morgan, the two granddaughters, in the more conversational styles, they have more monophthongal productions. In reading style, you start to see that those numbers drop. Now, they don't drop out, but they do drop. And again, Suzanne really doesn't change very much. She is pretty much categorically diphthongal. And so this was very interesting. And so when I started asking about what they thought about place, because this was before I had really had some of these, you know, fully concrete ideas. So Hazel talks about basically that she just grew up here. She sounds like everybody else, and she identifies with Hancock County. She just sort of says it kind of offhand. Hannah and Morgan, the two sisters that had the more monophthongal productions, Hannah said, well, you know, tough, that's tough. Appalachia is home. I love the hills. And Morgan said, and this is one of my favorite quotes of all time, I am straight up Southern, straight up Appalachian. You know when you're Appalachian, and I am one, both at work and in my private life. So again, now these are professional women. These are women that have had, that have, you know, post bachelor degrees, and they all work in fields where they present and talk for a living. And so this is something that was very interesting to me. And then when we get to Suzanne, she had a very different answer. She said, "I'm really a citizen of the world. I love home, but I don't think it's exactly who I am. I'm proud of where I came from, but I have a broader outlook now." So a very different discussion of home. So that sort of intrigued me, because I know Suzanne. I've known her for a long time. And I was curious. I was like, was she always so different? So the family provided me with some recordings that they had when Suzanne was in high school. Now, this was her giving a valedictory address. So in U.S. high schools, the student that has the highest GPA in a graduating class gets the chance to give a valedictory address during the graduation. So it's, you know, usually like in Stephenville, Hancock County, tons of people are in the gym. It's obviously a graduation. It's kind of a formal affair. So I wanted to take a look at this recording from when she was in high school. She was 17 or 18 at this time, and compare them to when I recorded her about 20 years later. So looking at the high school versus the interview, you're going to notice that two different bars are tall here. In high school, she was almost categorically monophthongal, whereas in the socio interview two decades later, she is almost categorically diphthongal. So you have a young woman who, over the course of 20 years, went from sounding very much like an Appalachian person to sounding very much not like an Appalachian person with respect to the monophthongization of I. And if you look at the Euclidean distance, so exactly how she realized those monophthongs, you can see in high school she had a very short Euclidean distance. So again, this was her production was very much monophthongal, whereas in the sociolinguistic interview she had much longer Euclidean distances representing a more diphthongal production. So both impressionistically and acoustically, she was very different as a speaker with respect to this particular item. So thinking about this, this was something that, you know, sort of captured my mind, because how she sounded in high school, in, you know, late adolescence or early adulthood, that may not reflect the productions later in life. And in particular, she talked about how traveling and seeing the world and different things like that sort of changed her conception of place. It changed her conception of home. She still loved home, but that wasn't necessarily who she was anymore. And so again, this idea of a person's orientation, their sense of place, can change over time. So sense of place seems to matter. Now, I want to know, and this is not something necessarily new, but I wanted to know if we could measure that sense of place. So it's great to say somebody, you know, their orientation shifts, but I want to know, can I put a number on that so we can more readily compare, you know, someone's place attachment, their rootedness to one another? Because I'm a numbers guy. I love qualitative work. I read it and ingest it, but to me, I like having a number. So I wanted to see if there's a way that we could get at it. And this is when I turned to some of our rural sociologist colleagues in the United States, and they have lots of writings and work on place attachment. Now, the particular scholars that I consulted, they were talking about place attachment surveys that they had used. And it was kind of funny in rural areas of the U.S. and how people felt about particular parks. So did they go and use this park? Were they attached to this sort of state and national park? Well, I took some of that work and I adjusted it for my purposes. And so that's where I started to develop the idea of my rootedness metric. So it combined questions that I asked during the interviews with a sort of a survey questionnaire that I gave them also. So sort of both how they responded and then how they responded to a written instrument. So I asked several questions during the interview. Do you like Hancock County? Where do you consider to be home and why? And do you think this is part of who you are? And depending on whether their response was overtly positive, I gave that a plus one. If it was neutral or I couldn't really tell, I just gave it a zero. And if it was overtly negative, I gave that a negative one. So from this part, they could have plus three to negative three. That was the range. I also gave them, again, this written instrument that I also sort of asked these questions out loud to them so I could record their responses. I asked 11 questions from these different categories: willingness to relocate, travel habits, where you say you're from when you're close and where you say you're from when you're far away, your family history, your aerial identification. So where do you identify with, or where do you say you identify with? How often and how much do you participate in local events? And then, of course, do you identify with Hancock County? So for my dissertation work, I interviewed 25 participants, 12 men and 13 women. 13 of them had at least some college, and so that also included some who went to community colleges in the area. And then 12 had only gone to high school, or they went to a trade school. So again, trying to get a balance for education level. Had an interview methodology, had an interview, a reading, and a word list. So again, typical sort of sociolinguistic style interviewing. And then I gave them the rootedness metric. I asked the questions, obviously, during the interview. And then in a subsequent session, I came back with the written instrument and then recorded that session, and they filled those out. So again, I'm focusing on in this particular section here, about the monophthongization of the diphthong I. So here, if you look at the Euclidean distance as by following voicing, so the voicing of the following consonant, you're going to see, and it doesn't really show very much on this, but here my speakers had a little bit more movement before voiceless than in voiced, and this actually was a significant difference. Now, that was an interesting finding, because a lot of the writings about Appalachian English said that there shouldn't be a difference. They should be basically the same. They're going to be monophthongal in all of those contexts. Now, they're still pretty monophthongal, but there is a little bit more movement in those pre-voiceless conditions. So that was kind of interesting. And then this is one that was quite interesting to me. The task where they had the shortest Euclidean distance and thus the most monophthongal production were in the reading tasks, and in particular, the word list. And so, you know, that kind of goes contrary to a lot of what we might expect, right? I'm giving someone something to read, so they should, you know, maybe orient towards or start producing more like what the standard or the mainstream production might be. But these speakers didn't do that. Then when you start adding in rootedness, things start clarifying. So in the pre-voiceless condition, as a speaker's rootedness increased, they started using more monophthongal productions. I should do it this way, more monophthongal productions. So they were using the more stigmatized, the more regionally noted form as their rootedness increased. And by task, as someone's rootedness increased, especially in that word list task, you can see that the more rooted speakers use the more stigmatized, the more regionally marked productions as their rootedness increased. So again, they're using the most regional production in what we might consider the most formal of tasks. And this was driven by their rootedness. So monophthongization was affected by the following voicing. That was something that I wasn't necessarily expecting. That was kind of interesting to find. And task did have an effect, but it kind of went contrary to what we might expect. And here, I think that we're tapping into that when you give someone something to read, and they're sitting across a local, someone that they know, and we'd also just been talking about place and how they felt about place, I think that they started to perform their identity and start that we had started to tap into the fact that we were talking about home, and then they started reading. Now, granted, the passages had nothing to do with home. It was Arthur the Rat and then one that I made that just had a lot of monophthongs in it, possible monophthongs in it. So it was very interesting that this happened. And so I'm still trying to figure out if there's something that, some other factor at play there. But rootedness sort of helped uncover and understand exactly what it was. And so rootedness being their attachment to place, how strongly they oriented toward place was one of the keys to start to understand this. Now, these same speakers, it wasn't just the monophthongization of I. Also, the way that they used pitch, and in particular, pitch accents. So I'm going to be comparing their frequency of certain pitch accents and also where they anchored the highest pitch point in the syllable, and including rootedness there as well. So I compared them to 8 Southern speakers that were not from Appalachia. So just wanted to see, hey, is their intonation different from other Southern speakers, or is this just a Southern U.S. feature and not necessarily an Appalachian feature? And then I wanted to see if rootedness played a role. So this is an overall distribution of the pitch accents. I'm going to point your attention to the dark blue column. You can see that it's, for every speaker, it's the second highest column. Now that is the L plus H star. So there's a dip in pitch and then a rise across a syllable. So that's the low plus a high pitch accent. Now historically, this has been called a contrastive pitch accent or a sort of a repair when you're really trying to draw attention to the fact that you're contrasting this. Yet these speakers seem to use this in non-contrastive elements. They just seem to have more of them. And that was kind of interesting because I was, again, not expecting this. And so then if you started looking at the frequency of L plus H stars and the speaker's age, you started to see, again, a positive correlation. And then when you overlaid the idea of someone's rootedness, the more rooted a speaker was, the higher the density of those L plus H star pitch accents. And there you're seeing something that sort of starts to tell a story, right? Where people that stayed, because they loved place, had the highest density of pitch accents. Now, I will say that some of these speakers that have the highest rootedness scores were actually some of the younger speakers in the cohort. So this is not necessarily just a fact of like, oh, all of the older speakers are rooted and the younger speakers are not. It's actually not exactly that. And I'm going to pull out a case study in just a moment to discuss that. So for realization, so where the pitch accent was anchored in the syllable, there was an effective gender, which some studies have found that Southern U.S. and also Appalachian English has a connotation of masculinity. And so in the sense that we had males using an earlier pitch anchoring, which is a feature of the dialect, is not necessarily unsurprising, but also the pitch accent by rootedness. So as a speaker's rootedness increased, they started anchoring the highest pitch point earlier in the syllable. Now, this is something that is subphonemic. This is something that is not necessarily contrastive, but it's something that that just sort of emerged from the measurement. And again, this is something that is not necessarily unheard of, because in the British Isles, looking at sort of pitch anchoring, there were some differences among some of the national varieties. But this is something where within a cohort, we were seeing differences based on how someone felt about place for their anchoring of this pitch accent. So a speaker's rootedness seems to matter. More rooted speakers utilize more of the feature associated with, so overtly associated with. So the monophthongization is known to be a feature of the South and is known to be a feature of Appalachia. So they used more of it. And it's also affected something that's very sort of lesser known, so rising pitch accents. And it also interacts with these other features, because if you just say, hey, it's going to be gender or education or something like that, and you're not including this sense of place, then you're not capturing everything to help explain and understand the language variation. So this will be the last thing that I discuss, but I wanted to pull out certain speakers just to demonstrate how rootedness had an effect. So Haley was a 27-year-old female from the cohort. She had the lowest rootedness of everyone. Hers was 18, but she had a master's degree and worked in education. Misty was a 37-year-old female, master's degree, worked in education. She had tied for one of the highest rootedness scores. And then we have Hugh. Hugh is an 84-year-old male who had a high school education. He was a retired business owner, and he had one of the higher rootedness scores. So if we thought about this, these three, sort of without considering rootedness, we might think, okay, we're going to see a gender effect. We might see an age effect. We might see an education effect. There's certain things that we might anticipate seeing. We might think that, you know, Haley and Misty will probably pattern similarly, and Hugh might be different, a little bit different, depending on what we're looking at and sort of how that may play out. So looking at Misty and Haley, when we're looking at their Euclidean distance, you're seeing that Misty has a much more monophthongal production of all of her eyes than Haley. So she is a much more monophthongal speaker. When you're looking by task, you're seeing that Misty was very monophthongal and got more monophthongal as you went from conversation to reading and got even more monophthongal as you went from reading to word list. Now, what you see with Haley is that she has, she's kind of monophthongal in the conversation. There's some overlap when she is in the reading, but when she does the word list, she shifts dramatically where she is now a very diphthongal speaker. And I'll just remind you that, again, these two women differed on their rootedness score primarily. Looking at their rising pitch accents, you'll see that both of them had a large amount of pitch accents, but Misty had more of those L plus H stars. And when looking at their anchoring of that pitch, Misty, the woman with the higher rootedness score, was much anchored much earlier in the syllable than Haley was. So again, you know, groups that we might think would pattern together, we're really not seeing them pattern the same, and rootedness might be the distinguishing feature. Now, comparing Hugh and Misty, okay? So again, we know that Haley is distinct from Misty. What about Hugh? What's he like? And you can see there's much more overlap. Here, now, Misty is a little bit more monophthongal than Hugh, but they there's a lot of overlap. When you're looking at the Euclidean distance by task, there's a similar trajectory. Now, Hugh is a little different in the reading passage, but you can still see that there's a lot more overlap. And notice there's not one task that's very different from these two. Looking at rising pitch, you're starting to see a little bit more. In fact, Hugh even has more of the L plus H star than does Misty. So again, he's older, and so that might play a role. But again, notice that those bars are not the same height. And here, there's some overlap, but you still see that Misty, who has a slightly higher rootedness score, still anchors her highest pitch point a little earlier in the syllable than does Hugh. So again, we have similar patterning, but not the same patterning. And notice that their rootedness scores are much, much closer. So when you start thinking about this, I'm going to stop sharing for a minute because I'm going to skip some slides. When you start thinking about some of these, you're going to think, well, what would be the reason between and how these individuals pattern? And it appears to be rootedness. People that we would think would pattern differently are patterning more similarly when you include rootedness. So what are the implications? Let me share this again, and I'll finish up. Okay, so the implications. This provides evidence that speech communities, even very small ones, are very heterogeneous, or more heterogeneous than we might think. And speakers are individuals, And any a priori grouping might be erroneous if we don't include everything. And so we need to approach all communities on their own terms, in particular with the idea of place and sense of place. All of these challenge the idea of a monolithic Appalachia or any region, and it's certainly an idea of a monolithic Appalachian English. That idea is gone. But even within a small community, so again, I told you earlier that this was a county of 6,600 in a town of 1,000, and even within a single family or a generation within a family, there's much variation. And in this case, one of the explanations, one of the rationales for the difference in the variation in this family was the differing relationships to place and their attachment to place. And I think that this could serve as a paradigm for investigating communities. Now, I've put rural in question marks because I've only worked in rural communities. I'm expanding into other communities here in Tuscaloosa and in Alabama, and I have some students and some other colleagues who are taking this and adapting it slightly for different communities across the nation and actually across the world now. So we'll have some more data soon to see how this affects other types of communities. So again, thinking about relationship to place is crucial. And even in small communities that you might think are going to be, oh, everyone's going to talk the same, that's not the case. So I will, there's all of this, the works cited, and I can send a copy of this to Dan for everyone to share. So I thank you very much for your attention, and I would love to hear your questions, comments, poems, rhymes, limericks. Thank you. Thank you very much. Yes, please. Lauren.
Oh, thank you. That was just absolutely fascinating. Thank you. So I've been thinking a lot about my own place and home lately. And so this was like very good timing for me personally, on a personal note, like being stranded away from family and coming up on the holidays. And I personally have a very strong identity with my home place equivalent. Mm-hmm. It's rural, not in the same way as Appalachia, but rural New Jersey. Mm-hmm. And so there's all sorts of stuff going on there.
Yep.
Now, but I haven't actually lived in New Jersey since I was 18, since mm-hmm. I went off to university. And that's not entirely true, but I haven't lived for any substantial time since leaving for university. And I was wondering whether you know or have any speculation or know any studies that would suggest how the natural accommodation one experiences being away from one's home influences compete with that sense of identity. Yeah.
So that's a great question. And so that some of that work with some of the people that I know who have left Hancock County is ongoing. So I'm trying to collect some data now to look at that. I will say in that Reed 2014 paper, one of those sisters did not live in Appalachia anymore. Now, granted, she still lived in the South, so there's a little bit of that. But she was actually the most monophthongal because she talked about how, you know, she missed home so much. So she actually overdid it, you know, but like she was the most monophthongal. And so that's one thing that's very, very interesting. So in Bridget Anderson's work, when she was looking at the migrants, she found that some people who, again, didn't live there anymore, still had the features. But then, you know, obviously you start shifting a little bit because you're getting different input. Then we start getting into thinking about exemplar theory and things like that. But there is still the idea that some of those features, and it appears to be either the most stigmatized or the most, I don't want to say caricature, but the most evocative of home tend to be the ones that stay longer. So you might think about, okay, you know, you've not lived in rural New Jersey for a while, but maybe X feature or Y feature is still present because it is the one, right? It's the one that signifies home. So there's some other ongoing work. So the closest that I would think of would be Katie Carmichael's work with those that have left Chalmette. And then trying to think others that they've looked at, sort of some of the work of looking at those displaced communities, although it's a little different though, because it's some of them were forced away. So that's not exactly the same thing as like, hey, I'm going away to school, or I'm leaving because of economic opportunity or something like that. So it's not exactly the same, but those would be some places to start that they may have some other ideas. But in each of those, again, there were certain features that were, again, the most meaningful or the most, those that were closely associated with home that still carried the day.
Now I'm going to have to listen to whether I still produce any of the features, if I can even think of features.
I was trying to think. I was like, okay, so that would be, like rural New Jersey. I'm like, okay, so all, you know, because you kind of got the split where you got the sort of the Philly stuff and then the NYC stuff, but that you're talking about.
I'm right on the border between those two.
So that would be kind of fascinating thing, but okay, is it some interesting amalgam of both of those? Is it something completely separate? Because again, rural New Jersey, it's not, you know, like, it's what is, I'm trying to, my brother-in-law is from right outside of Philadelphia, and I'm blanking on the Cherry Hill. Okay. So he's from there. And then, I had another friend who's from Hoboken. So like, you know, those are sort of two ends where you're like, hey, one is like, look, you're looking across the river to New York. The other is like, look, there's Philly. So I think that would be kind of interesting to see how that plays out.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Other questions? Karen?
Again, I thought that was great. I must say I really enjoyed it. And I'm all for people working in rural communities because that's what I did for my PhD. My question, though, is slightly different. And it's about some research that I've been reading recently that took place in the Netherlands that also looked at this issue of place belongingness. And they seem to produce really good evidence that demonstrated that it was quite dynamic and scalar from the point of view of the individual. So obviously you've got some of that with Suzanne, who clearly has changed over real time, if I picked that up correctly.
Yes.
Versus Morgan, who has pretty much stayed the same and is the same in her workplace as she is at home.
Yes.
But their work seems to suggest, and I suppose I'm just interested in it because it's something I've used for new research that I've done about migrants in Northern Ireland, that in a way, it's also possible or seems possible for an individual to move up and down the scale of place belongingness at the same time. So it's not, you don't, the passage of time doesn't have to happen. It can simply be your context. So it's not so for Morgan, but I'm just wondering if you've got any evidence of individuals who, you know, in the same moment in time can go from the coffee shop to their workplace and be two different individuals when it comes to monophthongization or pitch level or whatever.
So I'm very close to one because you're looking at him. So I, and it's one of those where when you start turning the, you know, when you start turning the camera lens to yourself, it always gets kind of like, is this what I want to be? Or is this what, I would say that a lot of Southern academics and especially Appalachian academics are like that because we have these very strong ties to home. But if I were to have presented my work the way that I might talk to my mom or my grandmother on the telephone, there's certain things that come along with that. And now as I've gotten a little bit older, that sort of little voice in my head saying you shouldn't say it like that starts to get fade further and further in the background. But I would say absolutely. And I think that the idea of that dynamic and even scalar nature that you mentioned is exactly it. Now, I don't have evidence of that because I have these, you know, sort of snapshot sociolinguistic interviews at this point in time. And then with Suzanne, you know, sort of like two from two different time points. But I mean, having lived and listened, I think you're exactly right that there's that underlying sort of sense of place that and rootedness that's there that you know based on other things. So the formality of the situation, the certain you know, certain context, the interlocutors. I used to share an office with non-Southerners, and so I had to try really hard to lose my pen merger because I could never get them to hand me 10 sheets of paper because she thought I was talking about metal. And that's not a joke. That literally happened. She turns around and gives me this really quizzical look. I'm like, I just need some paper to write on. And she said, oh, I thought you were talking about metal. Because I said, hey, can you hand me about 10 sheets? And she's just quizzical look. No, I didn't actually try it, but that's just kind of a joke. But the idea that I, when I was say things to her, I did have to think about, okay, are there any, you know, before nasals in this? So I think that we all do that to a certain degree. Now trying to find out how to get that would be, I guess that would be one where I mic somebody up and give them the recorder and let them just walk around with it all day, which would be awesome. Mm-hmm. And I have an idea for my next project now. But that, I think that would be it to sort of where, you know, you just get someone throughout the day or throughout several days, maybe in different contexts, kind of like Padesva's work.
Yes, and the same with, you know, Penny Eckert's idea.
Exactly.
In a way,
exactly.
We, you know, we pop in and out of communities of practice.
Yep. Absolutely.
In our daily lives, depending on which community of practice we happen to be in, that dictates, you know, whether we're pinners or penners.
Absolutely. So there's a question in the chat. Thank you very much for this. I have a question, if you don't mind. People who are proud of their dialect features, couldn't their reason be a sense of belonging to the people rather than the place? I would say absolutely. I think that sometimes with certain groups, those are one and the same. Because the, you know, when we talk about place, we're really talking about the people from that place. Now, I self-identify as a hillbilly, as a mountain man. I love the mountains, but it's more the people who reside in those mountains. So I think when we're talking about the belonging to people or belonging to place, that we're sort of talking about slightly different sort of views or perspectives of the same thing. Now, the belonging to the people, if someone has, it's a community that is, that, you know, that exists in different places or that has potentially been displaced or some type of diaspora, I think, yes, in that case, what we would be talking about then is belonging to the people, not necessarily affiliated with place. So yeah, I'm thinking about all sorts of different communities around the world that share lots of language features and sometimes share the language itself. And it's not necessarily, you know, rooted to a place, but it's to the people. But I think in reality, when we're talking about this place attachment, it's the place attachment to the people of that place or the characteristics of the people of that place. So I think we're sort of saying the same thing. It's sort of getting at it a little different way because sometimes places exist in the minds of speakers and places exist in sort of the popular imagination. And in my case, Appalachia and sort of broad, like the U.S. South more broadly, exists in the minds of people from the United States. It's something that, you know, I mean, you can think about Dennis Preston's work, like when someone's going to draw a map and they're going to circle where people sound different, everyone draws the South, right? But not everyone draws every single small community. So I think for some groups of people, it's the place that they reside. And so I think that in that case, you're absolutely right. Yes. Okay. I'm trying to see if that's another question. Oh, that sounds like a fascinating talk. Okay.
I've got a question.
Sure.
So you've spent all this time talking about individual differences, basically, with identity with place. And so now I'm going to scale it up. I'm wondering if, I guess, different places could, on the whole, if you like were to administer your rootedness metric to a good sized sample of that place, if you'd have different levels of rootedness or placeness for different places, and how is that? Okay, because I was sort of thinking about this in the context of like dialect leveling and where it may or may not happen that maybe the more rooted places might be slower or something to uptake that. And it seems like you'd have a way of quantifying that to really scale it up.
Yeah, so I'm giving it to more and more people. So and so and sometimes I think what we're getting at is where we're starting to see that, you know, each individual has their own particular root, but then people do start to sort of like coalesce around certain things, right? So there's lots of, because all of my speakers from these samples, if you were to listen to them, they're going to sound very Appalachian to you. Like, I mean, it's not like if you're not from the region, there's going to be certain things you're like, well, they all sound Southern. Like, well, you know, that's what a lot of people say. Like when I play the tapes of sometimes, or tapes, the recordings, people are like, oh, they all sound Southern. I'm like, yeah, but some of them sound more Southern and less Southern. And that's where it starts to come in. And so I think that, yes, at a certain level, there are certain places where there's going to be a sliding scale and there may be groups. What I'm finding in my work in Alabama is that it appears to be urban versus rural. There's variability within those, but the idea of the rootedness seems to affect the rural people more, which, I mean, intuitively kind of makes sense, right? But the interesting thing is that I found that Huntsville, so this is a city in North Alabama, Birmingham, sort of like the principal main city, or historically main city of Alabama and historically the most populous, Tuscaloosa, the university town, and Mobile, another historical sort of port city, all of them have similar features. So, I mean, there's some, I mean, obviously there's individual variability, but like on the average, but the rural areas, there's a lot more variability from North Alabama to South Alabama. And that is, and rootedness appears to, again, to play a role in that rural variability, which, again, I think starts to speak to what you're saying, that I think there are certain places where the rootedness will, you know, potentially have more of an effect. And then I would assume, just based on some of Carmichael's work and others, that cities where neighborhoods really matter, that might start to play a role where you're, I mean, it may not be the city as a whole, but maybe your neighborhood. And so there are some students who are sort of adapting this, my rootedness metric to look at neighborhoods. So there's a student at Wisconsin that's looking at Puerto Ricans in Miami versus Puerto Ricans from the island. So again, starting to see that idea of obviously rootedness to the island, but just that you're going to start to see that does place, like their actual physical place, matter. So I start, you know, starting to see some things like that. Does that answer your question? I don't know if I've actually.
I think it does. Well, I was thinking New Orleans, St. Louis type cities versus, you know, like Raleigh and, you know, some like Huntsville would be a good example of because NASA's there, right?
Yes, I'm trying to get some people up there to interview, but as of yet, there's this freaking pandemic that's just hamstrung everything. I'd gotten some students, they were ready to go. And then the university said, yeah, you can't just go roll up in people's houses, which granted I wouldn't send them to people's houses anymore anyway, but that's just, so that was just like, oh man. So, yeah. Stay tuned about Huntsville because Huntsville has also just recently passed Birmingham for population. I think there's kind of like they're like neck and neck now, which historically it wouldn't have even been close. And so that's going to be, again, an interesting look and to see, you know, Huntsvillians, you know, that are, you know, pre-NASA and then I guess now and then sort of the NASA Renaissance. Did NASA ever go away? I don't know what you would call that, but there's a lot of population migration in to the Huntsville area.
Yeah. Well, and what you mentioned with the cities being their thing and then the rural area being different reminds me a lot of like Eric Thomas's paper on Texas.
Yep. Mm. Yep. Yep. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Other questions? Sure.
Sort of going in a totally different direction, I'm curious about the pitch accents and the melodies that you're describing. So I'm going to put you on the spot. Can you produce that contrast of one in?
Sure.
Okay.
Yeah. So I'm going to put it in a contrastive environment, just so that way you hear it. But we're going on Monday, where you get the dip and then the rise. But again, so that sounds totally natural, right? Because I'm correcting you. You said Tuesday, no, we're going on Monday, right? So that's the kind of accent, but it's happening all the time in non-contrastive places. So you're just having a conversation and like, yeah, I went to the lunch, or I went to the barbecue lunch. I went to the store. My family we went over there last week. So you're getting all of these like these dips and rises, and they're not contrasting. I didn't, because I'm sitting there quietly, because I'm like, you know, I was taught how to be a sociophonetician. You sit there quietly and you do your feedback like So I'm not saying anything to for them to contrast with. And so here's a totally random personal anecdote. But when I was at South Carolina, I was walking across campus to, and I was walking around one of those orientation groups where they have the little, the tour guide, you know, it's like one of those where it's always in the way. So I was like having to weave through the crowd, and I'm walking past this mother and daughter. And as I'm walking past, I hear them talking to one another. And I knew in my bones that they were from East Tennessee. And it was like weird. Like I was like, they're from home. And being the, you know, I don't, didn't run into very many people from East Tennessee and South Carolina. So I walked up to them, not thinking about how weird this sort of interaction was about to be. You know, large 6'8" man walking up to these complete strangers and knowing something personal about them didn't really cross the cerebrum at that point. But anyway, so I walked up and said, "Hey, y'all from East Tennessee." And they're of course like, "How did you know that?" And I had, in that moment, I had to tell them, "It's the way you talk." And this was where it was weird, because the mother said, "Oh," like she was kind of offended. And then I said, "Well, you sounded like home." So I immediately salvaged that. But then the daughter said, "But I've tried to not sound like home." And so the question was like, the thing was, first and foremost, that was like a dagger to like the soul. But then I was also like, because it wasn't their vowels. It wasn't, you know, it wasn't like any consonant. It was the way they talked. I'm like, oh, there's got to be like loads of stuff written about, you know, this intonation, prosody. And so then I looked, and there was literally nothing about Appalachian intonation aside from one sentence in Joseph Sargent Hall. He did recordings in what is now the Great Smoky Mountains National Park. In his book, there was one sentence where he said, "The strength through which stressed syllables are uttered sometimes makes the non-stressed syllables almost disappear." That's it, which seems more like prosody than it is intonation, but that's it.
Yeah.
And then there's one other sort of allusion to it in Kratus Williams, an Appalachian studies scholar. He sort of founded sort of Appalachian studies as kind of a thing. In one of his books, he talked about the high pitches of the Appalachian mountaineer, something like that. But obviously, if he's talking about high, it has to contrast with low. So two sentences, only one in the scholarly literature. And so I'm like, well, let's start to look. And so I started seeing all of these rising pitch accents, which I think can kind of explain what both of them were hearing. So this has been around. So this is something that is noticeable. But until someone points it out to you, you're like, oh, yeah. And if people have told me, if you listen to me, I have a lot of those rising pitch accents because I seem a lot more animated. I am pretty animated, but I also seem more animated sometimes than I actually am.
So does that... Yeah?
Oh, go ahead.
So does it not seem to have a consistent function or structural location?
No. So that was, in some work that Nicole Holliday and Rachel Steindl-Burdeen and I have done, we compared Jewish English, African-American English, Appalachian English, Southern English, and Midland English. Interestingly enough, Jewish English and Appalachian English are patterning more similarly than the others, which... we have yet to find some sort of social explanation for the connection between these two groups of rural East Tennessee and, you know, NYC metro area. But the idea of the pitch accents being something that is distinctive. And so maybe that's what we're tapping into, is that it just makes you sound distinctive. Now, granted, you add in the segmental information and no one's going to mistake, a Jewish person from NYC from one of my rural Appalachian folk, but their pitch accents were similar. So it doesn't appear, there's not a nuclear versus non-nuclear distinction. It's not just in phrase final, in the length and foot, they just have more of them. Now, because we were comparing reading passages. So that sort of, even then we're starting to think about, okay, this should be similar, or because now some of the work I've also done is from conversation. So, but yeah, it doesn't appear to have a particular function or a particular place.
Thank you.
Yeah. Karen?
Just while you're chatting there, the intonation pattern of Northern Irish English is very similar in certain respects. Mm-hmm. And actually, mm-hmm. Lauren, there's no function either. There's no particular function associated with those, you know, essentially high rising terminals, but they don't have the same kind of function they would have for a valley girl or whatever.
Exactly. So that's, I mean, and that's the other thing. So, these, looking at these pitch accents, it's not just at the end. And that's the other thing is that
that's what's interesting about yours. Yeah.
Yeah. Is that go ahead.
No, just is the actual thing I was going to talk to you about was, you haven't come across any dialect literature written in the Smoky Mountains, for example, that highlights this kind of pitch to I dialect, for example, or peculiar spellings. Because that might be an interesting thing to look at.
Now, granted, they've tried to do the vowels. And so obviously that gets, and then sometimes you'll get these, where like all caps are used. It doesn't read as like they're trying to get the pitch accent. It seems to me more like they're trying to get the prosody, is something I didn't have time to get to, but the prosodic rhythm is different between Appalachia and the South, and the more rooted speakers have a more stressed timed rhythm than everyone else. So it seems like every time or at least everything that I've thrown at rootedness, monophthongization, pitch accents, other vowel features of the Southern U.S. vowel shift, prosodic rhythm, rootedness is there in some capacity. And again, it's one of those of it's because place matters and the sense of place matters. But I've not seen anything that it looks like they're trying to get at the pitch accents. Now, I will say there's been somewhat of a movement away from I dialect in a lot of the Appalachian literature. So for the last, say, 20 to 25 years, people have put more of the grammatical features in. So like, the was leveling, auxiliary don't, like to think that they'll put those in, but they won't necessarily try to spell them oddly. They'll put them in to make the characters ring true, but they won't do it in such a way where it impedes sort of just typical reading. And so I'm thinking about here, like authors like Silas House, David Joy, Amy Green, some of those are just, they've moved away from that, partly because of, I think, the success of Silas House, because, he's had several bestsellers that have not used that. Now, 50 years ago, and especially like 70 years ago, you saw a lot more of that, but they don't appear to be referencing the pitch, at least in any consistent way that I can sort of puzzle out. I will say, I dialect kind of offends me at sometimes. So like, I get angry.
So, well, maybe think about naive spelling then in historical documents.
That's true. Yeah. Ooh, that would be a good idea.
You see, there you go. There's
so
good
many
ideas
good ideas. I've got, all right. I got my next like years is now being filled up.
No, the next years is the Appalachian book with Christina Totora.
And that can be put into the book, right?
Exactly.
All right, there's a question in the chat. As someone with a weak accent and a family of people with broad accents, I find this fascinating. If an accent is based on a person's sense of place, and that sense of place can change over time, how do you think that would look on a graph? Could a person have an aha moment? Yes. A couple of the speakers would tell stories, usually very painful stories, about when they were made fun of. So one of the, Haley, the young woman who had a very low rootedness, she talked about how she was doing a voiceover she had to narrate a PowerPoint. She's a school teacher. She was a school teacher and she'd gotten promoted. But she, during her teacher training, she had to narrate a PowerPoint for her classmates and they all were just playing them. Now she went to school 35 miles from where we grew up. So this is not like she was, states away. She pressed play in her classroom and her classmates laughed at her accent, including some of her classmates who spoke English as a second language, which of course to her was like this even more of a death knell. And so she had that moment of like, no, I have to do something different. So some people have these very painful moments. Others don't really talk about a particular moment. They have a moment when they've realized they don't sound like they did. And sometimes that's with Suzanne, she did tell one story, like she had gone away to school and then had traveled a little bit and then came back and was around her high school friends. And she realized they didn't quite sound the same. She didn't have like a moment where she's like, I'm going to change. But she did recognize that, hey, I now don't sound the same. So I think you can have a little bit of both. So I think some people would have, you know, a graph where like there's this, you know, a break or, you know, like an acceleration of a change, where others, mm-hmm. it might just be this. And I think that kind of depends on that person's interactions. If they have one of those painful moments, and again, I don't think it has to be necessarily always painful. I think it'd just be where something is pointed out to you. But oftentimes those do wind up being kind of painful just because it's sort of pointing out a difference. And so sometimes those are like stick out in people's minds because of the stigma that was involved, especially when you're talking about US Southerners or other non-mainstream speakers. I know that in lots of work, you know, African-American English speakers have this, and it oftentimes mm-hmm. is something that is, it's usually ridicule, or sometimes it's not necessarily ridicule, but it still reads as denigration. And I think that that's the one thing where, yeah, you'll probably see some graphs with a bend, but others, there may not necessarily be that. But I think probably more often than not, there's going to be graphs with a bend.
I kind of wonder if the bend could go in the other direction too. I'm specifically thinking about when I do talk to my family, or when I was able to go back, and they'd say, oh, you sound so British. And of course I don't, but they're clearly picking up on something I've accommodated and brought back mm-hmm. with me. Mm-hmm. And how fast do I then switch back based on it?
Yeah, I think then we have to start thinking about, you know, including in exemplar theory here to see like, okay, how much is that really just a factor of the input, right? Because I mean, you guys are in Newcastle. That's, you're getting inundated with non-rural New Jersey vowels and consonants, your non-St. Louis vowels and consonants. So that's bound to have at least some level of effect. Yeah, I mean, not like you're gonna all of a sudden be like, you know, I can mimic a like Southern British accent. I can't mimic like a Newcastle accent, you know. But
you can put Sean on the spot. I think he can do it. Sorry, Sean.
I can do me best Geordie accent if you want.
That's perfect. Excellent, Sean. Now, why is it that since I've been in Newcastle since 1993, I still sound like this and I don't sound like Sean?
I was going to say,
have you heard my short A's? Like, and those have been pointed out to me at, you know, younger, like, oh, you say this word weird. And I'm pretty sure I doubled down as the response to that and went harder on it.
And I think that's it. And because there were also some people who talked about when someone pointed out their accents, and they basically just said a big F you to the person and said, this is home. I sound like my mom, my grandmama, you know, my mama, my papa. Like, this is how we sound. Thus, this is how I'm going to sound. And I think that,
like it or lump it.
Exactly. And I think that, and again, part of the reason that these places have existed in sort of the popular imagination is because of the fact that there is this sense of place and it is home. So like when we talk about Appalachia or the South or a lot of these places that can appear to be marginalized, you get a real bifurcation, right? Where some people, oh, it sounds like a hillbilly, but notice I said it sounds like home. So I know full well that if you sound like that in certain places, people are going to make fun. And I'm kind of to a point now, like, what are you going to do? I got letters after my name. You can't take them away. So it's sort of like that now becomes, so I've noticed that literally over the last, say, decade of my life, I've started to sound more like home. Not in every context. And I know, I don't think Zoom always captures how Southern I do sound in certain circumstances, but I think that is definitely there too. So I think you could see, you know, grass bending the other way where you're like, oh, you think I sound different? Just wait. Right. So I should have made that one go up. So that should just wait.
Right.
But I think that's definitely possible and probable.
Yeah, and actually it's interesting with the four of us with our cameras on, all being instructors in a place that has a very, or a substantially different sound to where we're from. I mean, I assume Alabama and Eastern Tennessee have a substantially different sound.
So where I am in Alabama is technically in the tail end of Southern Appalachia. So, and it's kind of interesting. So the culture of here is rooted around coal mining, is sort of historically was around coal mining. Cause again, you know, Birmingham was the steel city. That idea sort of is sort of all of sort of Central and Southern Appalachia share that. Not granted, it is different because it's way too flat here. Like I joke that I can see too far, but that there are sort of elements that do ring very much like home. Mm. And it's actually only about 4.5 hours from where I grew up. It seems like a long way, but it's the interstates are great. Thank you, Eisenhower.
Yeah. So I'm just thinking now about how I change. It's somewhat conscious and somewhat I can feel it happening, just totally unconsciously, how I've got my teaching accent, which I can hear myself putting on right now, which is not how I talk with my family or even my partner. Different vowels, different stops, different aspiration after stops, and just how I don't have control of that either. And it's almost like the classroom is another place that I orient to.
Yeah. I have a colleague, actually it was a student who mentioned, you should study the YouTuber sound. And I was like, I don't think I understand what you're talking about. They're like, watch a bunch of YouTube, like the influencer YouTubers. And there's this way of sounding. And it's like it's like, hey, make sure you smash that like and subscribe button. And they have these certain, but there's this way of talking that when you hear the guy, influencer. And once the student pointed it out to me, I was like, you should do a thesis. And then they fled in terror. But the idea was like, hey, that seems like something. And I think that you may be tapping into it that we all perform in some, teaching is partly a performance, right? So I think that there's partly. Also sometimes depending on the day, a whole lot of performing, but I think that we all have this notion that, and part of it's from who taught us, and but it's like we don't sound like in a faculty meeting, we don't sound like when we're like you said at home with our partners, it's something different. And I joke that that's my Professor Paul mode, because I don't sound, and people who have like been in my classes who are my friends or have heard me speak, they mention that they're like, you sound like a professor. I'm like, well, that's kind of what I'm supposed to do, right?
Yeah, so that brings a little twist to the bye.
Yeah.
Thanks. Well, we've got on quite a bit, I suppose. Mm. But that brings quite a twist to the idea that you could orient towards or change towards or change away. Because then it's even on like this micro level.
Yeah.
So I'm wondering now, like, how different your family, your two generations would sound if they were speaking to some, like a couple of different types of people. So people maybe they haven't known since childhood, but who are from that area, or maybe someone who's from like a totally different area.
Yeah. I mean, that's where you start tapping into things like, you know, with John Rickford's work where, you know, your Foxy Brown was very different with, you know, the African-American interviewer versus the European-American interviewer, where it was almost as if, it was almost like, you know, depending on the feature looked at, it was almost like it was two different people. I will say several people that I interviewed for my dissertation work and subsequent work have said, I wouldn't talk to anybody but you. And so there's that of where I don't know if we would have great evidence. I mean, I'm sure the people that would agree would, obviously there would be have some shift, but I think that some people would just not talk. So then I don't even know if we would have like, even the best picture of that. So what I want to try to do is take some of my students with me the next time I go and say, so they're in because they're like, I've given my, you know, seal of approval. I guess that's, which sounds weird, but so that way certain people that may have said no would still say yes because I'm there, but it's the student doing the interviewing. And then that, I want to see how that plays out too, because several people have mentioned this idea about my insider status in the community, which there's nothing I can do about that. It's home. But at the same time, I'm curious to see what, and then if people do change, what changes? Is it monopolization? That's something that, you know, might change. Aspects of the Southern Shift, people don't even necessarily know about that. And certainly things like the prosodic rhythm and the pitch anchoring, I don't even know how you can. I mean, I'm sure you can change it because obviously people do it, but it's like, how would that, like, how does that change?
The amount of conscious control that you need, even like highly trained phoneticians who work with prosody, like that's so hard to manipulate, especially in spontaneous speech.
Absolutely. Because like I've tried to see if I could adjust my pitch anchoring, and I can, but it's so different that it like it goes from like an L plus H star to, you know, an L star plus H, where it gets like this really long to it. It's like it becomes something different. And it's interesting. So I mean that there's work to be done. There's work to be done.
Oh, well, this has just been absolutely fascinating. So I guess I'm the host now.
You are indeed, yes.
So are there any other questions?
I should say we've got time for one more question if there is
okay.
one. Let you get on with your day.
Well, the good thing is it's only like 11:30 a.m. here. So like I've got...
I was just going to say, it must be very early for you.
Yeah. I'm not going to lie. I'm out driving into my office to get on like secure, like, you know, the best internet that I know. In my head, I was like... Okay, I checked the time and I'm pretty sure it's 6 hours, but then I had like a moment of panic of like, I'm going to get there and they're all going to be. And so I jumped on the, like I got here and jumped on the Zoom. I'm like, okay, I'm early. Okay, good. Cause in my head, I was like, I've got plenty of time. I've got like an hour to sort of like, you know, get coffee and sort of like chill. And I was like, oh gosh, was it 6 hours or was it seven or was it five?
Especially during the pandemic when we're really experiencing how time is fake.
Because like the other day I was, because we've shifted to all virtual instruction for the last part of the semester, and so my students have all emailed me like, hey, what time do we meet? And I was like, class time. They're like,
the same time as usual.
They're like, what time zone? And I was like, oh, that's a good point, because I don't ever have to specify, because they're normally all in, but now they've all gone back home. So some of them are on the East Coast, some of them are on the West Coast, some of them are, you know, in Central Time. So I've had to specify, you know, Central Standard Time, just so that way we all have a good reference point. Because they were asking, especially like for a couple of assignments they have to turn in, they're like, is it due by like midnight East Coast time, West Coast time? I'm like, I really don't care, because due dates are artificial too, but I have to impose them. So just turn it in when you're done.
Yeah. By the way, that doesn't apply to any of our students.
Oh, well, actually, you know. Nicole, you're set.
I'm sorry, students. Yes. Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah. Due dates are firm.
We're really Sophie strict. And Claire, they know the due date rules. We've talked about this, and we're going to be talking about it again on Thursday.
Firm, so firm.
Don't you be listening.
Yeah, firm.
Don't you listen to Professor Paul.
Yeah, sorry. The due dates are firm, and they are rigid and like they're immutable.
You'll be shocked if it's 1 minute past.
If it says 11:59 p.m., it must be there by 11:58, just in case.
That is correct.
not if we had our druthers, but according to the draconian system that we are bound to.
Exactly. If we had a choice, it would be mañana.
Exactly.
Anyway, it's been absolutely brilliant to... for you to come, Paul, and fantastic.
Thank you very much for the opportunity. Thank you for your attention and your questions. Feel free to reach out. I'm pretty easy to find. Just Paul Reed, Alabama, usually gets people to me. But if you have any other questions, I'll sort of clean up the PowerPoint a little bit, and I'll send that to Dan for him to distribute. And I know that this was recorded. So again, those of you that watch this later, if a question occurs to you, feel free to, you can at me on Twitter, pretty easy to find, PERJ44, just my email here at Alabama. So any way that you can reach me, I'm happy to answer any more questions, or if you have comments or suggestions.
I just put that together.
That's me.
Oh, hello.
So my avatar on Twitter is, I think, is it me? It used to be like I had a fMRI done. And so it's a mid-sagittal view of me. And then I think that, I can't remember if that's, and so then I also had one like, you know, that would be my, like my author pose, like the, so got one of those. So that's, yes. So we're tweeps, by the way.
Yes.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm gonna have to go together.
Yeah. Yep. And I've got to go as well, but it was absolutely brilliant. Thank you.
Thank you all very much.
Bye-bye,
take it
guys.
Easy.
Guys. Cheerio, students.
All right, bye.